Welcome to another hearty one-to-one, and my guest this week is English rugby legend and Sussex County Cricket Club CEO, Rob Andrew.
So, thank you for joining me, Rob. The eternal question, how was lockdown for you?
Yeah, hi, morning. Good to be here, of sorts. It'd be nice to see you in person soon, but yeah, like everybody else, it's been really strange, hasn't it? Really difficult in many respects for lots of people. But yeah, no, we've been okay. We've got the lockdown puppy, so lots of dog walking. Yeah, just busy and strange and very challenging in terms of, you know, as you know, trying to keep a business running.
Yeah, yes, indeed. Before we come on to the cricket, go to your first chosen sport, rugby. My little neighbours were cock-a-hoop a couple of weeks ago because they started mini rugby again. What do you think COVID will do to rugby, grassroots rugby?
It'll be really interesting, as with all sports, you know, just to see how grassroots sport comes back. I actually think there'll be a bit of a growth in grassroots sport. I think people are just desperate to get back out. I think it's made people realise just how much they took for granted their grassroots sport and how much they really miss it. We saw that with cricket last summer when we were allowed to play. There was a massive boom in people just wanting to get out there. And I'm sure the kids, you know, the boys and the girls in mini rugby, having not been allowed pretty much out all winter, to get back out with their friends, to get back to the club. I mean, fundamentally, just to get outside and be allowed to run around, have a bit of fun.
In front of the computer and the TV, it's, you know, it's awful.
We've all been, you know, challenged with being stuck in front of this, you know, damn thing, quite frankly, for pretty much a whole year. The mental health side of things that we've talked about a lot in the last 12 months, just to be able to get outside with your friends. You know, I think grassroots sport will do well out of this in a funny sort of way. I think there'll be some financial challenges, of course, because clubs, you know, have been shut and not been able to have their doors open. So we've all got the financial challenges, but I'm hopeful that actually this also makes people realise just how important exercise is, how important your physical health is to go with your mental health, and that people, government included, recognise how important the physical health is of the nation, because it has a huge knock-on effect to the mental health of the nation. So, you know, time will tell, obviously.
Do you think with club rugby, this is almost an opportunity, or albeit in a roundabout way, for clubs to cut their cloth accordingly now financially, almost press the reset button? You know, I know my own local club, Worthing, have had a long, hard look at their wages and their budgets, and they're virtually going to slash them.
Yeah, well, I think that's a very long-standing debate that the game has had. I was involved in rugby for a long time, 10 years at Newcastle, 10 years at the RFU. There's no need for clubs like Worthing to be paying extravagant wages. You know, I'll get shot for saying this, but a lot of clubs should be amateur at that level. You know, and the financial challenges that this has forced on clubs. A lot of clubs were stopping paying players well before COVID. And if this has forced others to do the same, then I think that's really, really, you know, people can't afford it. And there's a certain level of professional rugby that the game can sustain. And even that's challenged at the Premiership level. So I think there'll be a massive readjustment. And I think that'll be good for the game in the long run.
Great. So let's go back to cricket. So I'm going to take you back to Feb 2020. So you were looking forward to a, you know, to a summer where T20 signings, county championship, the start of the 100, and then March came and it all went wrong. Sadly, circumstances beyond your control. How did that affect Sussex and cricket clubs, you know, the length and breadth of the country?
Yeah, hugely. I mean, none of us really saw it coming. None of us have lived through it. We got shut down effectively, like a lot of businesses. In fact, the first team were on tour, pre-season tour in South Africa when this all started. So we had to scramble to get them back from South Africa in the middle of March. Jason Gillespie came with them back from South Africa, back to Hove, and we immediately sent him straight back to Australia. Said, you need to get back home because we're going to be shut down here for months to come. He eventually came back in August and September when we finished, when we did play for the 2 months.
Yeah.
But we were just, you know, just scrambling really to keep the club afloat. When you're a business that relies on people coming through the door and you've been closed for 13 months, we still haven't had anybody through the door. Nice. And still haven't now as this season starts, as with the football club and rugby clubs, all entertainment industries just closed. So it's had a huge effect, and a lot of revenue that we've lost hasn't come in, as with all county cricket clubs, as with all sports clubs. So we managed to get through last year the combination of sort of cost cutting and salary cuts across the board, furlough from the government, which has kept a huge number of businesses afloat. And now we're trying to work out how this summer plays out. So we're not through it yet. That's the other thing. You know, we still haven't got anybody in the ground. So we were reasonably prudent on our budget for this year. Great to be back playing cricket. It's so sad in a way. We had Yorkshire last week. We've got Lancashire this week. We've got Kent in a couple of weeks' time at Hove, and we're not going to be allowed anybody in the ground to watch those matches, which would have been great matches for people to watch.
Yeah, I mean, COVID has proved that sport is nothing without supporters. And we know that, and I've said this to you before, that I wouldn't say it's quaint with Sussex, but I still feel like that little boy that went through the gates in 1974 to watch Tony Greig. Unfortunately, and it's well documented, I feel like a customer when I go and watch the Albion play. But have you got an idea when you will be able to have supporters back?
From the middle of May, we will be allowed to start having some fans back. We're working with the Sports Ground Safety Authority at the moment, who have to basically approve what we plan to do. And I think everybody's looking at sort of 25% capacities, maybe rising to 50% in June. We still don't know. This is the big uncertainty. What is going to happen after the 21st of June, which is the sort of magic day. Mm. But we don't know from a sport perspective yet if that means back to 100% capacities, which I doubt very much, but we're working on that. And from a budgeting point of view, we're just hoping that we can get anywhere, 50% would be fantastic for this summer if we could, and more the better. But there's still a lot of uncertainty, as we know. But we do expect some crowds this summer from the middle of May onwards.
Yeah. Yeah, because going back to the mental health thing for certain people, and I don't want to be ageist, but probably more men of a certain age, county cricket is their life. Watching county cricket is their life. You know, if they're retired and, you know, they're a Red Bull fanatic, it is part of their life. So to take that huge part of their life away, we really need to get it back as soon as possible.
It's hugely important, men and women. We have a lot of male and female members of the club who love the club, as you know. Yeah. And You know, they spend a lot of their winter just wishing the winter away to be able to get back to Hove in the summer, and yeah. and then missing out on that time of their lives. You know, so we're very hopeful that very soon we will get them back into the ground. You know, it's tough times for them. Yeah. You know, hopefully with our communications and obviously with modern technology, and a lot of them are getting in, you know, we stream all of the matches now, so you can watch the matches, and the coverage is, you know, is getting better. So hopefully they're still in touch, but they, you know, fundamentally they want to be in the ground, don't they?
There's nothing. The TV stuff and the streaming has been superb, but as we all know, there is nothing like being there. There's nothing like live sport. And I hope sports in general appreciate that it's nothing without fans. And there's almost like a sea change. You do look after your fans, as do the Albion look after their fans stroke customers, but some don't. And I hope that sort of changes. Moving on to the finances, you know, and you touch on a very, very important point. Have you had any funding from the ECB or from the television people sort of helping you through this financial crisis?
Yes, I mean, obviously we get a television distribution from the ECB. They sell the TV rights for all cricket in England, and that comes into the game, and then it's redistributed to the counties. So as with all sports, and it's an interesting argument, this, one of the reasons that we are playing behind closed doors is to make sure that our TV revenue comes in. And our TV revenue for football, rugby, cricket is actually the thing that's kept us alive. So we've got this conundrum where we, you know, of course we want the fans back, and behind closed doors sport is nothing like having the fans there, but we have to play it because we have to fulfill television contracts, and obviously people can still see it. And we need the finance, because without that television finance at the moment, we would be in serious trouble, because all of our other revenue streams have dried up.
Yeah.
So, you know, yes, we've got some membership money, and the members were very generous last year, and a lot of members donated their membership fee. But we've had no ticket sales for T20. We haven't sold a pint or a food or a sandwich or an ice cream, we haven't had a dinner, we haven't had a function at the club since February last year. So all of those revenue streams have just dried up. So without the television money, sport would be in serious trouble. And we're all trying to manage our way through 2021, which is not going to be normal. We're now praying that 2022 will be normal. But, you know, those are the decisions that we're having to take.
Yeah.
TV and the ECB television distribution has been critical to cricket, to rugby, to football. Without it, I dread to think where sport would be.
No. We all remember the noughties, and obviously with Sussex were the Manchester City of county cricket back then. We are due a transitional season, or a transitional period, shall I say. It doesn't have to be one season. In a way, COVID, with the sort of salary issues and the financial issues, lets us have it, doesn't it? Without fans sort of moaning about recruitment and results.
It's a very good question. And nobody likes the word transition. You can hide behind it as an excuse. And it's not an excuse, you know, at the moment, it's a really difficult balance. We do feel that we need to rebuild a Red Bull team. We haven't been right with the Red Bull for some time. So we have taken a very deliberate decision at the back end of last season with the appointment of Ian Salisbury and James Kirtley. We've got a terrific academy coming through. We saw some of that at the back end of last season when we played the youngsters in the Bob Willis Trophy. we're going down that road. They've started this season, you know, put up a great fight against Yorkshire, and we are going to let this team build and grow over this season and into next season and beyond. We still want to do well. We still want to be competitive, but we do recognise just where we are with the Red Bull team, the county championship team. And you just have to look at the comparison of experience of that Yorkshire team versus the experience of the Sussex team. There was no comparison, but our guys were terrific. And there's some real talent there, and we've got to let that develop and grow over the next couple of years. And we need to build some consistency and some continuity over time, which is what the team in the noughties had, and that's what all the best teams have. So we need to build that. We have got a slightly different white ball, and I know people will hate the red ball, white ball discussion, debate, but it is what it is. We have a much more experienced group of players, many of whom just play the short form of the game now. So we can almost change half the team for people who come into our T20 side. And as we've shown over the last 2 or 3 years, you know, we are up there with the best T20 sides in the country.
Yeah.
We haven't got over the line to win it, which is obviously disappointing, but we're in there with a very good side, and we're trying to keep balancing the growth of the county championship side with the competitive nature of the T20 side. I will not compromise this. My number one priority is the financial security of the club. We've been around for quite a long time, yeah. Sussex. In fact, yeah. We have played at Hove, or we will be have played at Hove 150 years next year, when the club moved to the current ground in 1872. So we just have to make sure that we protect that, which is the point you made around, yes, we have cut our cloth accordingly with the budget for this year. And we have to be sensible, because in cricket in particular, the business model is we don't have a chairman who funds the club in the way that often rugby and football are funded. So if we, I keep saying to the chairman, you need to put your hand in your pocket, but he's got deep pockets and his arms aren't very long. I'm only joking. But look, that's the reality of it. So we just have to make it work.
But no one in their right mind, no cricket fan would mind you cutting your cloth now, because we still want you to have a cloth in 2025 and 2030. And I think some people don't realise how much of an impact COVID has had.
The majority do. They absolutely, and the majority have been fantastic. Our sponsors, our members, everybody has been absolutely amazing. And there's been a real coming together. And we all know, and I've got to know this over the short time I've been at the club, you know, that the depth of feeling for Sussex cricket in the county is huge. It's a fantastic feeling to be part of that, because I know just how much people care about the county and how much people want the county to do well. And we all do. There's nobody more competitive than me. And I hate losing, but we all as a board have a wider responsibility to ensure that we protect the long term. The county has such a rich and long history, and we're trying to protect that and continue to grow it. And we're actually very excited at the moment about the group of young players that are coming homegrown, that are coming out of the county, and have got an opportunity, we think, to, you know, be a very special team over the next few years.
Right, Rob. I want you to put your salesman hat on now. Sell me the 100, because it's totally gone over my head. Why should I watch it? What's it all about? And what are the benefits for us as Sussex County Cricket Club?
Yeah, it's obviously one of those things that's new, and therefore, if it's new, you're always going to get people who don't like it and don't like change and traditionalists. I'm pretty open about it from a personal point of view. I think that change can sometimes be good. There is no doubt that that white ball cricket has saved cricket financially. Traditionalists won't like to hear that, but that is the reality. And you look at the strength of T20 cricket around the world, and the finance that brings in. It also brings in challenges with test cricket and county championship cricket. And that's the biggest problem that the game has is at the moment is trying to fit everything in. And obviously throwing in another competition adds to that. But it also brings in, you know, new finance, which has come through from the ECB into the county game as well. So, yes, we don't have a team that is going to play at Hove, a men's team anyway. We hope that the women's Southern Brave team will play next year. They would have played this year, but for COVID. And it brings in significant new finance that's shared around the 18 counties. You know, an extra 1.3 million per annum for 5 years. That's a lot of money.
Yeah.
Whether you like it or not, whether you like the competition or not. So I sort of treat it very much as almost part of. An ongoing revenue stream for Sussex County Cricket Club to help us grow, help us develop, and keep us solvent. Is it going to succeed? None of us know, do we? It's like anything in life. People didn't, you know, and I've said this a few times in lots of sports. I played in the first ever Rugby World Cup in 1987. People said we didn't need a World Cup. And a World Cup wouldn't work in rugby. Well, that was false. You know, people have said that rugby would never succeed going professional. You know, it's had challenges, but it's been a huge success professionally. People said in 2003 that T20 cricket would never catch on. Well, I think it probably has. So, you know, the proof will be in the pudding because it always is. And we'll just have to see how the next couple of years plays out with the 100.
Don't forget, they all laughed at Christopher Columbus, didn't they? So,
absolutely.
And we'll finish on a traditional red ball cricket. England are going down or due to contest this winter the oldest cricketing test match series, the Ashes. Do you think that will happen down there in front of capacity crowds?
Well, I couldn't say about capacity crowds. I mean, we all hope that it will happen as a tour. You know, crowds and capacities and government regulations are very, you know, we don't know, do we? The same with the Lions going to South Africa this summer. It looks like they're going to go, but, you know, there's not going to be any following fans. So might be the same with the Barmy Army, might not be able to get into Australia. Which might be, you know, an excuse to keep the Barmy Army out of Australia for the Aussies, to keep it quiet.
But isn't that with the Lions and the Barmy Army? Because I've been down there twice. That's taking something away from the competition, isn't it?
Hugely. I mean, hugely, and it's such a shame, and it's so disappointing if the thousands of Lions supporters won't be able to go to South Africa. And if the Barmy Army can't get to Australia, it is tragic at one level. But what would we, you know, what's the option? We'd rather
first.
The matches took place, wouldn't we?
Without a doubt. So, England are talking about rotating, Rob. What's all that about?
Well, I think they tied themselves in knots a bit this winter, didn't they? And I think they, you know, you can see what you can see to a degree what they're trying to do. Players are in bubbles and they're fatigued mentally and they're trying to get through a very, very long season. England have got an enormous amount of cricket this year, including India coming here, the T20 World Cup before the Ashes. So you can understand the fear of burnout. But yeah, you know, who knows? Let's just hope that everybody's fit. They get to Australia for the Ashes. And certainly from a Sussex point of view, that Jofra is fit and firing and he's on quick wickets in Australia and he's making them jump around.
Rob, absolutely superb stuff. Thank you for joining me. Hope to see you in the boundary rooms very, very soon for a drink.
Take care. Cheers. Nice to talk to you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Great stuff from Rob there. I will see you next time on Hearty 1-to-1. Thank you for watching.